How many people are familiar with Dr. King's speech, The Fierce Urgency of Now?
I hope this is because people are being shy.
How many people are familiar with Dr. King's speech, The Fierce Urgency of Now? And if you, real quick, can you just stand up and summarize what his main point was for the audience? You're not that familiar with it, okay? What about you, brother? Brother Derek in the back.
Yeah, so really just the urgency in just in terms of not only specifically how we need to be much more progressive and engaged in each other, but also politically and socially. Knowing and understanding who we are and the challenges that we face as a nation, but also making white people recognize their
right, and one of the reasons he had that speech is because he was pushing back against the concept of gradualism and incrementalism. Everybody was saying, come on, Negroes, why don't y'all slow it up a little bit? Stop asking for so much. How dare you want to be men and women and equal and powerful? Why don't you just take it a little slow? And he was talking about, no, now is the time. And so what I want to point out for us is that we're living in a time that is very similar, the fierce urgency of now. And one of the things I want to do to set the context of the conversation that we're going to have is really remind you all that your seat is still warm. So what does that mean? How many people have ever sat in a chair that somebody had just been sitting in before you got there? And you sit down and you feel it's still warm, right? And so what I'm saying to us is that many of us in this room are sitting in seats that are still warm. And they're warm because they are still drenched in the blood, sweat, and tears of our ancestors and our forebears who have fought to get us in these seats. And we need to be accountable for what we're doing and not doing for the opportunities that they died for us to have. And I would argue that many of us are not being accountable and are not holding one another accountable at the level that we need to, given that we are in an urgent situation. We have black mayors, we have black city council, we have black police this and black fire that, all the way down the line. We have black people in the office of economic opportunity, and yet still, when you look at his data, and when you look at what I'm going to show you, we still have an urgent crisis when it comes to black employment, black entrepreneurship, and black wealth. How many people know what economics means at its root? What is economics? Economics was actually in the first video that you saw when they were telling you what they were going to do with your habitat. Economics is simply the law and the rules of the environment. Eco, ecology, habitat, nomics, laws of. So when you're looking at people telling you what they're going to do in your neighborhood and you were not at the table, that's economics. It's more than wealth, it's more than finance. It is really the rules that control everything about the habitat that we reside in. And many of us are not, even though we might have PhDs in economics, but we are not in economics right now. Because other people are deciding for us where we live, how we live, and what the rules are in the places where we live. You can't get more urgent than that. There's a report, and the report name is at the top, Employment Pathways for Boys and Young Men of Color, because I really want to center this down to hopefully a space where we can become serious about it. And as you can see, 2000, 2009, 2015, look at the black percent of males employed by race. What do you notice compared to other ethnic groups? What you're going to notice is that particularly as it relates to recently, we are on the bottom. There's been a steady decline of youth in the workforce since 2000, and our brothers in particular have borne the brunt of that. So from age 16 to 19, when you look at the range for black, what that's telling you that 2015, we still had a very limited percent compared to every other male group in that age range of brothers in the workforce, brothers employed. Black and Latino or males of color, we have to be very careful because not all of us bear the burden the same way. And we have to become a little stronger and more powerful about the particular burden that's borne by the ethnic group that we represent. So when you look at this, this is telling you the unemployment rates for out-of-school males by race and education attainment between the ages of 16 and 24. If you have less than a high school diploma for black males, you're above the 50% mark in the unemployment rate. The only other group that shares that burden with you and that actually exceeds that burden with you are Native Americans. If you look very carefully with a high school diploma, black males, again, you're talking above 30%. So with a high school diploma, our brothers between the ages of 16 to 24 had the highest unemployment rate in this country compared to all other ethnic groups. Mm-hmm. When you look at Latino males, less than a high school diploma, their unemployment rate is actually less than for Latino males with a high school diploma. Can anybody make sense of that?
Some people drop out of school to help out their family businesses.
Because they got family businesses. So again, they have an economic infrastructure in the Asian and in the Latino community that can absorb their men, even without a high school diploma, that we do not have in the African American community.
I'm finding so many different mentalities. It seems challenging. I don't say hard, because the only thing hard is being concrete that you walk on. Everything else is a challenge.